how do we think about it? Let's consider a popular metaphor. Attention is a spotlight that accentuates the information we care about while bedimming or obscuring information of secondary importance. When our spotlights work well, we can focus on what we're doing. When our spotlights are dim or scattered, our mind wanders off task. This is incredibly frustrating. We hate this. I can totally relate. However, I want to suggest that this view of attention is incomplete and it can be misleading. In fact, I want to suggest that there is some value in having a spotlight that does scatter. Imagine you've decided to go on a road trip. You're going to drive from Manhattan all the way to Los Angeles. As you're driving your way west, are you focused entirely on keeping your car between those dotted lines? Or do you perhaps start considering whether you should have a career change? If you're anything like me, you have the latter experience, an unintended shift of attention from the task to internal information. Your mind wanders. Now, I bring up this example to highlight the fact that most of our mind-wandering experiences are successes in that we can both do the task and we leverage surplus attentional resources. We don't squander this stuff. Now, the second thing to highlight is that if we perhaps hit a snowstorm in Denver, our system would recalibrate. We would probably stop considering this career change and instead focus on keeping our car on the road. Point being, we're reasonably good at figuring out just how much we have to attend to what we're doing and whether we can get away with thinking about other things. Now, the last thing I want to do is ask you to imagine a world where you couldn't do this. Imagine that as you're beginning your journey, you merge onto the West Side Highway and you encounter the following, dun, 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 a ton of traffic. That's you way back there. What do you do in this mind-wanderingless world as you inch your way closer to the exit? It's just your brain, your odometer, and the vanity plates on the car in front of you. In practice, mind wandering is an efficient way to leverage what I would consider to be our most precious resource. Moreover, we enjoy doing it. We use it as a source of entertainment when our worlds are invariable or impoverished. One of the most amazing findings that has come out of cognitive neuroscience research in the last 5 years is that when people are doing an easy task, and it doesn't matter what that easy task is, it could be pressing a button when they see a dot appear on the screen or turning a lever when they hear a certain sound, what you find in their brain is that they have activity related to the specific task, but across all of these easy tasks, participants recruit a network of brain areas that we refer to as the default network. Now, this is strange because people are unconstrained by the task, and yet their brains all appear to be doing the same thing. How is that possible? Well, it's thought that this network is associated with some default state of the human brain. Quite what that default state consists of is the subject of some debate. Now, given that we have this mind-wandering habit, my colleagues and I thought you would expect that at least some of this activity is associated with reflecting on internal information. To go after this idea, we brought participants to the lab for a week, every day, for a week straight, and we trained them on a difficult task. And they got to the point where they could perform the task on a limited amount of material and also mind wander. What's key is on the final day of the experiment, day 6, we bring them to the imaging center and we scan them while they're doing this task nonstop for 40 minutes. Except for sometimes they're doing the task with the material that they've practiced with, and sometimes they're doing the task with new material. And what we find is that periods of successful mind wandering, when participants can both do the task and they think about other things, they recruit this network. Now, what this suggests is that we perhaps have a default psychological state that consists of reflecting on internal information. And then once our worlds present us with some sort of challenge, we depart from this baseline to focus on the task, and then once we can manage it without having to fully pay attention to it, we return to this baseline of introspection. It's as if our minds are drawn to rest here. Now, where the mind wanders is not irrelevant in this story. And what I would argue is that mind wandering frequently involves our attention being hijacked by what I call open goals. Open goals are unfulfilled intentions. So perhaps you want to win the Nobel Prize in 40 years. That's an open goal. Maybe you had an argument with a friend last night and it's unresolved. Open goal. Perhaps you just have to pick up toilet paper after this TED talk. This is all unfinished business. Now, consistent with this idea that mind wandering frequently involves our attention being hijacked by this stuff is a wealth of descriptive research. So we know that the majority of mind wandering episodes involve people thinking about this stuff. In fact, people tend to spend the most time mind wandering to thoughts of their most important open goals or open goals that have impending deadlines. Mind wandering isn't just random. Those tasks you told your brain you care about, those open goals that are unfulfilled, they exert a gravitational pull on your attention. What you have to keep in mind is that at any moment in time, you've got that task that you're currently pursuing. You guys are trying to understand my TED talk right now. But you also have hundreds and hundreds of open goals that you also want to achieve. To manage all this stuff, you have to remember those open goals in the background. They have to be accessible to you. And you also have to be sensitive to information that's relevant to their pursuit, because you may want to stop paying attention to what I'm doing and shift your attention to something that's more worthy. If I'm overly focused on this TED talk, I'm going to miss that woolly mammoth backstage. If when I go home tonight and I'm flossing my teeth, I'm too absorbed in that task, I'm less likely to remember that it's Granny's birthday and I need to call her. To be successful in this world, we have to find a balance between two fundamental dynamics. We have to focus on what we're doing, and we have to monitor the environment for something more important that we should shift our attention to. The latter is just as important as the former. Now, the problem with metaphors is that they highlight key aspects of a phenomena while obscuring the importance of other features. I would argue that this is just half of the story. In addition to having a spotlight, I think we have an attentional watchdog. Your watchdog's looking to please you by fetching something that you told her you care about. You say, come here, watchdog, this is tenure, this is important to me, and this is toilet paper, we're running out, get me some of this. And your watchdog is constantly monitoring the environment, looking for something related to these goals. Your watchdog, she's very hardworking, she's very loyal, but she's not necessarily patient. She will start barking at, you know, something, whether you can do something about it or not. So if you're flossing your teeth and she's barking at Granny's birthday, you can actually act on that. You don't notice her then. It's when you're giving your TED talk and she's yapping at toilet paper that you notice her. Your watchdog is not patient, and she doesn't know when you want to be alerted to things and when you don't. What you have to do is train your watchdog. You have to make your priorities clear to her. Close some of those open goals you have, or at least put them in some external repository so they're not all on her to monitor. And the next time you are having trouble focusing, don't simply look to fix your attentional spotlight. Consider the possibility that you should throw your attentional watchdog a bone. Great, thank you.